Howdy, Sam here. Today I'm going to go over setting up a redding bushing style full-length sizing die. I'll explain how to select the proper bushing to get an optimum neck grip on the bullet, talk about setting the shoulder back and sizing the case so that it'll chamber in your rifle easily. We'll talk a little bit about the theories behind some of the things we do and go over some of the tools we use to measure those cases and to set up our dies properly. Now I've got a whole batch of 260 ammo here I need to produce, so let's get started. Okay, before we get started, let's talk a little bit about what happens when you fire the cartridge. Now, when you buy a brand new piece of brass or a factory loaded round, that case is as small as it's ever going to be. Now, when you fire the case, it grows. It grows in several different places. One, it swells up right here in the case web around the head here. It grows from the end of the case here out to the shoulder to seal the chamber off. And the neck also grows, it releases to let the bullet come out. So what you have is a piece of brass that used to fit loose inside the chamber of the rifle has now expanded to fill that chamber to seal it off so you get pressure to launch the bullet. So what we're after when we size this case is to push the shoulder back just enough to let us chamber the round again easily in the field. And at the same time, we need to size the web of the case right here where it's grown enough that we get an easy chambering. The other thing we do is we size the neck back down to hold the bullet. Now those are the three things we're after when we full length size. Now a bushing die, what that does for you is it gives you the ability to control the amount of sizing you do on the neck, and that's it. So that's the biggest advantage to a bushing die over a regular resizing die. Okay, so after measuring a new piece of Lapua 260 Remington brass and comparing it to a twice-fired Lapua 260 brass from the same lot, I know that in firing, the case head dimension, in other words, the biggest part of the case right here under the rim, has grown by 1.5 thousandths in firing, and the length of the case from the case head out to the shoulder has grown by 8 thousandths from the new case. Now this case will chamber in the rifle it was fired from, and I could shoot it again without doing any full length sizing other than sizing the neck down to hold the bullet properly. The reason that we full length size everything for our hunting rigs is so that if there's any kind of moisture or dust or dirt or a blade of grass or anything like that that gets onto the case or into the chamber or anywhere else, we'll be able to chamber that round easily and hunt with it. You know, for field guns, where you're going to be out down in the dirt, basically, you ought to full-length size everything. Okay, so the tool that we use to measure our shoulder bump is called a comparator. This is a Sinclair International comparator body with a stainless steel comparator insert. Now this insert fits a certain family of cases, so this one fits 308, 260, 243. It's very simple to use. Just slide open your caliper. The comparator body just clamps to the anvil of your caliper. Slide it closed, zero it out for the comparator, and it allows you to measure from the shoulder to the case head. So when we get these numbers from our cases, when we come up with an average or the smallest size case, we'll record it and we'll set up our sizing die to push that case back 1/1000th. And the very first thing I do in the reloading process is knock the primers out of my cases before I start cleaning them. When I get to this step in the process, that becomes pretty critical. What can happen is if you leave the primers in until you size the cases and you take your measurement with your bump gauge, is some of your cases will have protrusions sticking up out of the primer cup from the firing pin hitting them, and some of them won't. Well, the anvil of the caliper centers right along that primer hole, and you could end up with cases that are longer than others. In reality, they aren't. It's just that the primer cup is protruding a little bit. So to get the best, most consistent surface to measure from, you really should have all your primers out of your cases before you take that measurement. Now, the first thing I do when I get a redding die is I I take the lock ring off of it because I hate them. It has a section of threads here and a set screw that comes in and jams that section of threads onto the die body and makes it impossible to finely tune where that lock ring is on the die body. Now, I use Hornady lock rings. They have an Allen screw here on the side, and all you have to do is loosen that, and it allows you to turn that die very easily. So it's very easy to adjust in small increments and then lock down. Okay, the second thing I do with a full-length sizing die, a bushing full-length sizing die, is I take the center stem and decapping pin out of it. And you need to keep this black piece here that screws onto the stem itself, because it'll take up the space between the top locking cap screw and the bushing. But when you get the bushing, it comes marked with what size it is. So this is a 293 thousandths bushing. And it's got markings on the bushing as well. Now these, you know, I put that back in the bag to demonstrate how it comes and all that, but when you get ready to size your brass, it's a good idea to clean the die just to keep junk out of it. You don't want any oil from machining or anything up in there, or if you've used it before, you don't want any excess lubricant from the last time you used it in there. So I just take a couple of patches and run them up inside the body and take a look at it and make sure there isn't anything in there. So the next step will be to drop the bushing in. Now this is a 293 thousandths bushing for my Lapua brass. In it goes. Then the black nut here goes down inside there. And then this lock cap goes on top until it bottoms out, and then I back it off just a little bit. Some guys say eighth of a turn, I say 16th of a turn. Just enough so that that bushing is just barely moving a little bit inside the cavity. And that kind of helps it let it self-center in there. Okay, I've got a pan of brass here that I've spray lubed with Hornady One Shot. The brass is very clean. You want to make sure that you keep the brass clean as well as inside the die. If you find that you're getting some scoring on brass, take the time to pull the die back off the press and clean it out and try to identify what the problem is before you keep going. Otherwise, it'll just keep scoring all your brass. Okay, now I've placed a shell holder in here. I'm getting ready to set the die up. I want to talk a little bit about tolerances. Now, there's all these different tools that we use have different manufacturing tolerances in them, meaning if I use this shell holder today and set the die up perfectly to where it's sizing the brass exactly how I like it in this press, and then somewhere down the road, I take the die out, I take the shell holder out, and then I put it all back together with a different shell holder, I could end up with a different shoulder bump altogether. And the reason that is there's tolerances built into all these little pieces and tools that are built. So something to keep in mind, and a good practice to get into, is to keep the shell holder that you're using with that die when you take it off the press and put it away. Okay, I'm going to set this die up now, and what I'm going to do first is I'm going to go by the directions that came in the die box from Redding, and what it says is to put the ram all the way up, screw in the die until it makes contact, and then back it out a quarter of a turn. So let's go ahead and do that and see where we end up. Okay, there it bottomed out. Quarter of a turn. I'll lock down my lock ring, tighten the nut, let's see what we get. Now remember, I'm trying to achieve a 1 to 3 thousandths shoulder bump to allow easy chambering the next time I put the round in the gun. So what I want to end up with when I'm done is 1 and 564 thousandths. Pretty close, 1 and 564 thousandths. So that's what I'm after right there, is that piece of brass. So let's check another one. One in 564 thousandths. Sometimes you get lucky like that. Okay, I've checked my brass. I found out that I have half a thousandth of case head sizing right here. I have 293 thousandths outside diameter of my neck, which will give me my 1.5 thousandths of bullet grip when I seat the bullets next time. The last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to check concentricity on a concentricity gauge here and see if I'm bending the cases in the die. My dial indicator is indicating that I don't have any run out at all in the case after running it through the die, which is a good thing. If you find that you have run out that's, say, 4 thousandths or better, meaning or higher, then you better stop and figure out how to get your die lined up perfectly square with the shell holder. Now, if you can't do that, then you have something wrong with your shell holder or something wrong with your die. Generally speaking, if it's a die alignment problem, you can place a shim of some sort between the shell holder and the die with the lock nut loose, apply some pressure to it so that you have a perfectly flat surface against a perfectly flat surface, and then tighten the nut down. I've had great luck doing that if you have a problem with it. Usually you won't, so it's just something to keep in the back of your mind. Okay, I've measured my size case dimensions. I've checked them for concentricity. I've put a piece of sized brass in my rifle's chamber to make sure it will chamber fine. Everything looks good. The last step will be to note all of my measurements and how I set up all my dies and everything in my data book here so I can replicate my load later on. The next thing I'll do is I'll clean up this brass in the tumbler for an hour or so, and then I'll start trimming the cases. Check out any of our other videos on YouTube concerning long-range hunting, long-range shooting, or long-range reloading. And until then, thanks for watching. See you next time.